Welcome to Untested Builds, where you figure out how to play as your favorite fictional characters in Pathfinder 2nd Edition. Like and subscribe for new builds every week. Comment below to suggest characters you want to see featured on the channel and join the Patreon to vote in polls for upcoming videos. This week, we're back to Waifu Wednesdays by building the titular character from the show Violet Evergarden. It's an incredible show filled with beautiful people, set to the most amazing score I've heard in an anime. Seriously, I'm about to drop some major spoilers, but this is a story that I would consider a must watch. So if you haven't, pause the video and come back and we'll be here when you're ready. All right, now that your heart has been thoroughly shredded, Violet Evergarden takes place in a world rebuilding after a great war. Violet, who had fought in the war as a child until she lost her special forces unit along with her commanding officer and both arms in a tragic battle. After adapting to her metal prosthetics, she struggles to find meaning in a world without her defined role as a weapon of war. Eventually, she is inspired by the abilities of the Ghost Riders of the CH Postal Service's ability to translate the feelings of their customers into letters that touch the hearts of the recipients. Though Violet struggles in this role at the beginning due to a lack of empathy during her upbringing, she eventually becomes one of the most requested writers in the industry, applying the same savant-level aptitude she displayed as a warrior in her new career. For our goals for this build, even though the war is long over, our skills remained sharp. We were already lethal, and that was before the military training. Second, we need to get our hands on some new hands, metal ones specifically. They're made for more delicate work, but I wouldn't want to get hit by those either. Lastly, our main gig is now that of a writer, technically a typist, mostly letters, but the occasional opera too. For our stats, we're maxing dexterity. We make the occasional grapple, but we're more of an agile fighter. Constitution and strength next, we're tougher than we look and we do make grabs on occasion. Intelligence next, we can do basically everything we put our minds to and we're not bad at just straight up memorizing ridiculous amounts of information. Wisdom and charisma go untouched at the start. Common sense and social interactions aren't really our strong suit. With levels, we'll increase strength, dexterity, constitution, and wisdom. We get way better at the intuition thing, and the initiative is nice too. We've got a lot of skills here, so buckle in. We're trained in thievery and intimidation, not saying Violet would, but she definitely could if she needed to. Performance and diplomacy, we've got to get a little poetic for the job from time to time, and politeness goes hand in hand with professionalism. We've also got crafting, not sure maintenance on prosthetics counts as crafting or medicine, but we're grabbing both anyway. Bar increases, we're taking expert society and master proficiency in stealth and warfare lore. We're taking legendary athletics and acrobatics because obviously, but also legendary scribing lore and survival. We travel anywhere to meet your request after all. If you've only watched the trailer for the show, you might be led to believe that Violet is some sort of artificial being. A few characters refer to her as a tool or a weapon, but that's just an obtuse metaphor. She's just a regular girl, a human girl specifically. Versatile humans gain an extra general feat at level 1, and the fleet feat for an extra 5 feet of movement speed is perfect for an agile preteen who leaves no survivors. Violet's true origins are still pretty mysterious, but we know she was found alone and didn't seem to know anything about interacting with other people. The lost and alone background gives us training in intimidation and warfare lore, and we get the intimidating glare feat to make a demoralized action as a visual trait instead of an auditory one so we can get past any language barriers. Violet isn't really one for active intimidation, but if I just saw an actual child take out my best soldiers while sporting a completely blank expression, I'd be a bit demoralized to say the least. For our ancestry feat, we're taking natural ambition for an extra level 1 class feat that we'll talk about in just a second. We're gonna lock in as a rogue. Violet can do basically everything that's asked of her, and rogues get twice as many skill feats as everyone else. They also get sneak attack to deal an additional 1d6 of precision damage whenever they strike a flat-footed enemy with an agile or finesse melee or thrown weapon or ranged attack. To help with that, they also get surprise attack, which makes every creature who hasn't acted yet in combat flat-footed to them so long as they rolled either stealth or deception for initiative. We'll choose the thief racket for flat damage due to our dexterity modifier on our finesse weapons instead of strength. We've got some basic first aid with battle medicine so we can treat wounds during combat, but the target is immune to further battle medicine attempts for one day. For our class feats, Nimble Dodge gives us a +2 circumstance bonus to our AC as a reaction to an incoming attack we can see. Tumble Behind is our main method of giving out flat-footed during the first half of the build. Now whenever we successfully tumble through an enemy space, the enemy is flat-footed against the next attack we make before the end of the turn. We'll take the Experience Tracker feat to track down a creature while moving at full speed by taking a -5 penalty. We've got our natural aptitude for violence down, but we're still a little raw. Not quite the soldier maiden of Light and Shaftlick just yet. We'll get put on the fast track to weaponhood eventually, but for now, we need some basic training. The Pathfinder Agent Dedication gives us training in Pathfinder lore, expert proficiency in warfare lore, and whenever we use a skill we are untrained in, we gain a proficiency bonus equal to our level instead of 0. Level 3 rogues gain deny advantage, meaning we no longer are flat-footed to hidden, undetected, or flanking creatures, or to creatures using surprise attack if they are level or lower. You gotta get up pretty early in the morning to get the drop on Violet. We'll pick up Rapid Mantle to grab an edge with our Reflex save instead of Athletics, and whenever we do, we can pull ourselves onto the ledge in the same action. We'll take the Adopted Ancestry feat. Violet is technically adopted, but honestly, we're just here for orc feats because, well, they're violent and the military is violent too. We're getting our first writing lesson with the Thorough Reports feat. We get to write down information about all of the enemies we face, meaning we get a +2 circumstance bonus on recall knowledge checks against creatures we faced before. The Reactive Pursuit feat allows us to stride up to our move speed as a reaction to an enemy within our reach making a move action to get away from us, climbing, swimming, burrowing, and flying if applicable, not that Violet does much of those last two. The world building is pretty grounded until you get to those prosthetic hands. Level 5 rogues gain weapon tricks to increase our proficiency in simple weapons, unarmed strikes, and rogue weapons to expert proficiency. We also gain the critical specialization effects of any agile or finesse weapons we crit on. And our sneak attack damage increases to 2d6 as well. We'll get some metal arms with the Iron Fist ancestry feat, meaning our fist unarmed attacks lose the non-lethal trait and gain the shove trait. Meaning we can add our item bonus from our fist attacks to the athletics attempt to shove if we have hand wraps of mighty blows or if your GM just gives you automatic property runes on your weapons. Our jumps get more powerful too. Powerful Leap increases our vertical leap distance to 5 feet and increases our horizontal distance by 5 feet. Violet basically has two ways of interacting with the world, through her job as an Auto Memories doll and as a soldier. With Creighton's cognitive crossover, selecting society and warfare lore, whenever we gain no information from a recall knowledge check in one of the skills, we can attempt a recall knowledge in the other as a reaction. Time for that more specialized training I mentioned earlier. The Swordmaster dedication gives us a +2 circumstance bonus on our reflex DC whenever a foe attempts to disarm us in case we're actually using a knife or a short sword as opposed to our awesome robot hands. Level 7 rogues gain evasion for master reflex saves and critical success results on regular successes, vigilant senses for master perception proficiency, and weapon specialization for an additional flat 2 damage with our expert attacks. We'll take the catfall feat to treat falls as 50 feet shorter when determining fall damage so you too can jump out of a plane, parachute part of the way down, then fall the rest unharmed. We're also getting the drop on our enemies too with incredible initiative for a +2 circumstance bonus to initiative checks no matter what skill we're using for the roll. A Pathfinder build really is the wrong format to talk about this character. You'd think she just spends all of her time embarrassing grown men in combat. The sidestep feat forces an attack that critically misses us to strike another adjacent target they can reach as reaction. We only get so many attacks each round, so let's put some of our enemies to good use. It would probably be good to know what kinds of attacks they have. The Recognize Threat feat lets us make a recon knowledge attempt against a creature we can see as a free action whenever we roll initiative. Level 9 rogues gain debilitating strikes to inflict a minus 10 foot speed penalty or inflict the enfeeble condition until the end of our next turn as a free action whenever we hit a flat footed enemy and deal damage. We also have Great Fortitude, increasing our fortitude saves to expert. The Kip Up feat lets us stand from prone without triggering reactions as a free action. A lot of free actions in this build. A lot of dedications too. The Multi-Talented feat gives us a multi-class dedication of our choice, and the Fighter dedication gives us training in all simple and martial weapons, opening up a whole new range of weapons we could potentially sneak attack with. We also get training in a skill of our choice, and this is where we finally pick up our scribing lore. Since we're already a master in acrobatics and athletics, and you're gonna have to build a life for yourself after the war anyway. We're also gonna need to learn some manners. The Courtly Graces feat allows us to use our society skill to make an impression with nobles we meet. We'll pick up some more savant abilities with eidetic memorization, meaning we can spend 3 rounds memorizing a piece of writing or inscription we see in order to reproduce it using whatever writing implement we have on hand until the next time we make our daily preparations. Human photocopier isn't something I expected to say when I started making this build, but the girl's memory is frankly impressive. Level 11 rogues gain rogue expertise for expert class DC and 3d6 sneak attack damage. Last time you were in an ambush, it went horribly for your party, so let's try to avoid that going forward. The Incredible Scout feat grants your allies a +2 circumstance bonus to initiative rolls when using the Scout Exploration activity instead of a +1. For our skill feat, Experienced Professional prevents us from critically failing when we use our lore skill to earn income by giving us a regular fail instead. We spent a lot of time completely butchering letters before we got good, but you don't have to roleplay that part if you don't want to. Who knows how long we went alone before we were found. The Rugged Survivalist feat increases the amount of time we can go without water to 3 plus our constitution modifier, and increases the amount of time we can go without food to 5 plus our con mod. We'll pick up some basic maneuvers with combat grab fighter feat so we can spend an action to make a strike and grab the target until the end of our next turn if we hit for guaranteed sneak attacks on the following turns. Level 13 rogues gain master tricks for master proficiency in simple weapons, unarmed strikes, and rogues weapons. Light armor expertise for expert unarmored defense and light armor. Pretty sure the dress she's wearing is heavier than the fatigues they gave her in the Navy, so we're going with unarmored yet again. Incredible Senses increases our perception proficiency to legendary, and improved evasion increases our reflex saves to legendary, giving us regular fails on critical fails and half damage whenever we will fail on a reflex save. Your allies won't be nearly as good at avoiding hazards though. Advanced First Aid expands our options when administering first aid. Now we can reduce their frightened or sickened conditions instead of only being able to stabilize or stop bleeding. The Hardy Traveler Ancestry Feat gives us a plus 10 foot bonus to our overland travel speed and increases our maximum and encumbered bulk limits by 1 to help us with that meeting people anywhere part of our job description. We've got 3 lore skills, so let's make them all a bit better. Unmistakable Lore gives us a regular fail instead of a critical fail whenever we roll recall knowledge with one of our lore skills. We also get more information on a critical success if we happen to be a master in the skill in question. The Protect Ally Swordmaster feat allows us to spend an action to give an adjacent ally a plus 1 circumstance bonus to AC until the start of our next turn, unless they decide to leave our side for some reason. Level 15 Rogues gain double debilitation to apply both debilitations whenever we successfully damage a flat-footed enemy instead of just one effect. Greater Weapon Specialization increases our flat damage on our Master Proficiency attacks from 3 to 6. The Cloud Jump feat lets us jump as high vertically as we could normally jump horizontally and triples our usual long jump distance just in case a client randomly asks you to jump across a pond for some inspiration. We also get another general feat, and the question is not if but when we're grabbing toughness for an additional amount of max HP equal to our level and reduced DCs on recovering checks because dying isn't part of our story just yet. We're able to carry even more equipment with the Hefty Hauler feat to increase our maximum and encumbered bulk limits by an additional 2, meaning we can carry anywhere from 65 to 130 pounds and still be able to nimble dodge. Maybe it would have made more sense to just build an android instead. The Martial Exercise feat lets us choose a weapon group, and whenever we gain an expert or greater proficiency in any weapon, we also gain that proficiency in simple and martial weapons of the chosen weapon group. Good for master firearm proficiency, but getting to use all the other martial knives at master proficiency is good too, depending on your setting. Level 17 Rogues gain Slippery Minds for master will saves and critical success results on regular successes, and our sneak attack damage increases to 4d6 precision damage as well. We'll take the Athletic Might Ancestry feat for critical successes whenever we succeed on athletics checks to climb or swim. The Snap Out of It Pathfinder feat, not to be confused with the martial feat of the same name, gives us even more ways to help out our allies. We make a medicine check to reduce an adjacent ally's fascinated, frightened, stunned, or stupefied condition. Violin is probably decent enough at first aid given her training, but this is more about how good she is at elevating those around her to be the best versions of themselves. We also got the wisdom to make medicine work, and multi-class and a bar just wouldn't make sense here. The Death's Door Swordmaster feat keeps us in battle no matter how grievous our injuries. We gain temporary hit points equal to twice our level for 4 rounds, once per 10 minutes as a reaction to taking damage that will reduce our health to 0, preventing us from becoming unconscious if we remain above 0 HP. The Connections feat is more of a speculation rather than something we actually see in the anime. We can use our society skill to arrange a meeting with a political figure to ask for a favor. Violet is still young and she's already renowned among the nobility and commoners as a writer, and she's practically infamous among the military for her past exploits, so it wouldn't be unreasonable for Violet to cash in some favors if she needed them later in her life. Level 19 Rogues gain Light Armor Mastery for Master Proficiency in Light Armor and Unarmored Defense and Master Strike, so whenever we strike a creature that is flat-footed and deal damage, the target makes a Fortitude save against our class DC, enfeebling them on a success, paralyzing them on a fail, or our choice of paralyzing and knocking them unconscious or killing them outright on a critical fail. Probably depends on if you're roleplaying violent before or after the end of the war. We'll take the Swift Sneak feat, which lets us sneak at full movement speed rather than half, and for our general feat, Feather Step lets us step into difficult terrain. We're finally a famous Auto Memories doll with Legendary Professional giving us the highest level writing jobs with our scribing lore. Probably still couldn't write a movement for an opera though, let's be real here. For our Capstone feat, we're dipping back into Fighter for Agile Grace to reduce our multi-attack penalty with agile weapons from 4 on our second attack to 3, and minus 8 on our third and subsequent attacks to minus 6. Our damage mostly comes from attacking multiple times rather than trying to deal all our damage at once, but we can talk about that more when we go over the pros and cons of the build. We deal some of the most consistent sneak attack damage of any character I've built on the channel, opening with surprise attack, following up with a combat grab, dealing sneak attack again, and grappling the target for our third sneak attack for another instance of sneak attack damage. Even if we're just using our hands, that's still 12d6 plus 36 bludgeoning damage plus 12d6 precision damage if they don't just flat out die on the first strike. We've also got some good support options using our plus 32 medicine skill to heal damage, frightened, sickened, fascinated, stunned, and stupefied conditions on the fly. We also do the rogue thing of being trained in basically all the skills for a minimum intelligence investment. For cons, we're all physical damage. Hopefully your medicine skills can be put to use if your GM puts an adamantine golem or whatever this world's equivalent of an M1 Abrams is in front of your party. We also don't optimize our damage in favor of more flavorful abilities. We don't usually worry about that when it comes to replicating pop culture characters on this channel, but taking athletic might in favor of just grabbing a climb and swim speed and getting persistent bleeding damage on our unarmed strikes, well, that just kind of feels wrong. We also have no charisma modifier, so it's going to be difficult to actually write a letter that can bring people to tears, since I'm pretty sure that falls under a performance check. But that's assuming your GM doesn't just ignore your character's personal arc altogether to just do their own thing. Either way, you'll be there to lay down some hurt, inspire the people around you, and keep all your friends safe. Thanks for tuning in to another build. If you're still here, why not subscribe? We post a new build every week. And if you want to help support the channel directly, join the Patreon to vote in polls for upcoming videos and make priority character requests. Or check out the Gumroad to download character sheets for all of our builds. Until next time, have a good week, take care, and play more Pathfinder.